So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gina Hechanova from the Psychology Department of the Ateneo, and we'd like to welcome you to this talk. This year, one added feature to our university awards is that it features talks from our awardees. Now, every year, the university seeks to recognize exemplary men and women for others. And we are very happy that one of the highest honors that were given that was given this year was to our very own psychologist and former faculty member, Dr. Honey Carandang, who was given honoris causa. The Honoris Causa Award for Science. So as part of the celebration of this award, the awardees have been invited to give a free lecture for the public. And we are very fortunate today that we have Dr. Honey Carandang to speak to us on parenting. Now, I've invited her former student, Dr. Lotate, also the former chair of the Psychology Department of Ateneo, to give us a brief background or introduction to Dr. Carandang.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker this afternoon. Dr. Maria Lourdes, Honey Arellano Carandang, obtained her MA in Clinical Psychology from Ateneo de Manila University. I will not tell you when. And her PhD in clinical psychology from the University of California at Davis with specialized training in child and family therapy. Dr. Honey's illustrious career has spanned more than three decades. She pioneered play and family therapy in the Philippines. She is a retired professor and former chairperson of the Psychology Department of Ateneo de Manila University. She is also a retired professor of the Psychology Department of the University of the Philippines. She has served as president of the Psychological Association of the Philippines. In 1995, Dr. Carandang was honored as National Social Scientist for her outstanding contribution to the field of psychology through translating scientific principles and applying them for the upliftment of Filipino children and families. In 2014, she became the first psychologist to be awarded Outstanding Professional of the Year by the Professional Regulatory Commission. And just last month, as mentioned by Dr. Hechanova, the Ateneo de Manila University conferred on her the degree of Doctor of Science, honoris causa. This is a traditional university award that recognizes the life and works of men and women who embody the values of the university in an exceptional manner. Part of the citation reads as follows: for dedicating 50 years of her life to lending her scientific knowledge and expertise for the well-being of Filipino children, especially those in difficult circumstances, through her pioneering work in child and family therapy, for her advocacy of children's rights, for her clinical practice and scientific research in clinical psychology. Dr. Carandang is a best-selling author. To date, she has written 13 books on the situation of the Filipino children and families. Some of these are Filipino Children Under Stress, Self-Worth in the Filipino Child, Ibalik ang Saya sa Pamilya, Children in Pain, and Nawala ang Ilaw ng Tahanan. After more than three decades of teaching, mentoring, research, publishing in journals, writing books, and clinical practice, Dr. Carandang founded the MLAC Institute for Psychosocial Services in 2010. The mission of the institute is to use the science of psychology for the well-being of persons, especially the poor, the marginalized, and the traumatized. MLAC Institute's major flagship program is Parenting is Nation Building, the topic of this afternoon's lecture. To help parents raise children with self-worth is one advocacy that Dr. Carandang is very passionate about. She has said a long time ago, in a paper that she wrote in 1988, that a solid sense of self-worth is the best gift that we can give to the Filipino child. On a personal note, I have known Honey for more than 3 decades now. That will give you an idea about how young we are. As a former professor, mentor, colleague, and friend, if I would be asked to describe her, the first thing that will come to mind is she walks her talk. Let's all welcome Dr. Honey Carandang.
Thank you, Lota. My longtime friend. Okay. Can you hear me at the back? Okay. I suppose if you couldn't hear me, you wouldn't be able to answer, you know? It's just that I would be happier if you were cozier, a little bit more to the front. Is that okay? May I request? Thank you. I know it's more comfortable there, but you know, you might fall asleep. That's not going to be very nice. Okay. Ayan, thank you. Okay. Ayun. Salamat. Okay, thanks. Okay, isang napakagandang hapon sa ating lahat, and I hope it's going to be a very, very fruitful time together. I always say before my talks that the most fruitful and the best part of my talks is always the open forum. So before I even start, I'd like to set the tone that what we'll do is I'll tell you what I know, but then after that I will stop and it will be your turn to ask questions or to give your insights, and it will be some kind of a dialogue. Is that okay? Is that a deal? Deal or no deal? Okay, so we got a deal. Okay, as Dr. Echanova was saying, and as Lota was also saying, Dr. Te was also saying, it's really my passion. Now, the topic today, I was made to choose what topic I would want to talk to. And there were so many topics in my head, but then I said, this is the one that I really, really believe to be most significant in our times, during our time now and always in the life of a nation. So thank you for choosing to be here and for recognizing the significance of the topic, that parenting is nation building, and we will see how that is later on, okay? I believe, and I am very, very passionate really about this topic, because I believe that it is the most important task of all in order to build families, in order to build a nation. It's also very interesting if you think about it. It's the most important task of all, and yet when we need, when we want to hire a driver, we need to find, he needs to have some qualifications, like he has to know how to drive, directions. When we need to hire a cook, he has to have some skills. And we need to hire a teacher, there are many skills and so on. But there's only one requirement to become a parent, is to have a child. So, as you see, we have not really given the attention that parenting deserves, no? Because it is one of the most difficult tasks of all, most challenging, and yet most significant in terms of our lives. So That's why we chose that in MLAC, we chose that to be our flagship program. So I'm very glad that you're here because I wasn't sure if people would be interested in the topic. But since you're here, I'm glad to see you. Okay. So there's so much to say about parenting. I think I was very kind of thinking hard about what I would focus on. No? But then I thought, okay, I'll just focus on some of the topics that are obviously directly relevant to nation building in terms of parenting. Okay, so let's start with Mother Teresa. Why? It's very interesting because when Mother Teresa was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1979, at the end of her acceptance speech, she was asked, "How do we promote peace in the world?" And her answer was, "Go home and love your families." So it's a very, very large thing, the world, and yet she zeroes in on the families, no? When we go back to, when we look at how to promote world peace, we talk about the basics, which is the family. And there are many ways of building a nation, a strong nation, and that are very, very important. The systems, the structure, the macro, it has a systemic way, which is very, very important, which we have been trying to do in our country. But today, let's go back to the roots. Let's go to a micro level. Let's go to the family, which is, I believe, the backbone and the foundation of the country. And I still believe, and I'll tell you why later, why the family is still the most basic and the most powerful social unit you can ever belong to. I'll stand by that, but I'll explain it later, okay, why I believe that. So for now, let's start with something very, very important, discipline. When I keynoted the Philippine Child and Adolescent Psychiatry Convention last month, Dr. Banaag, the president, talked only about discipline. And he was saying that what happened to discipline in the country? What's happening? Discipline doesn't seem to be really that important anymore, or what is it? He was questioning where discipline has gone in our country. So let's zero in. On some practices that we may see as possible roots of the lack of discipline. No? I always believe, and I think it's very important to always know that when we discipline our children, we aim for self-discipline, because we can see that even as adults, if the policeman is not there, okay lang lumusot. If the boss is not there, okay lang gawin yun. So it's really quite external, and therefore it's not really what's called self-discipline. Because I believe that if it's discipline, real discipline, it has to be internalized. It has to be part of the self. Not just when the punisher is there, you don't do it, no? So that's the external, in psychology, the external locus of control, internal locus of control. So it's very important that we always link any discussion on discipline to be self-discipline, especially as you can see now in our country, in the traffic, whatever. Okay, let me just cite a few practices. One I call pinagtatakpan. Now, this is very common when, for example, the child does something that's punishable. The mother says, "Wag na lang natin sabihin sa tatay kasi baka kung anong gawin." No, it seems very innocent and very, very unimportant. But a message that can be absorbed by the child is that it's okay to cover up the wrongdoing. You know, it's very simple, but a message comes through sa pinagtatakpan. So we also observed, to jump to the macro level, we also observed in some administration we'd had in the country, some president, whatever, that one of the things that had been happening was all the crimes, I should say, most of the crimes were covered up. And so now that we are trying to bring out, open the covers, there's so many things that come out that are sometimes very difficult to even handle and accept. No? Misbehaviors, crimes, etc., corruption that had been covered up. And covering up became a way of doing things. For some time, as you know, in our country. We're trying to open up now, and of course, everything is coming out, and it's not very easy. It's also not very safe for people who are telling the truth. So, pinagtatakpan goes a long way, and hopefully, it's not going to be the practice after a while when we are able to tell the truth and do what is needed for people who have done wrong. Okay. The other one is sinasalo. So ako na lang gagawa para wag mahirapan. I'll do it for my son para wag na lang siya mahirapan. Or you let your kuya do it so para hindi na mahirapan yung bunso. Something like that. No, we have that kind of thing where we rescue our children from hard work, maybe from punishment. And I think if you think about it now, I get a lot of requests now, and I have a very recent request for a group of parents asking about why their children seem to be entitled. Entitlement, no? Parang entitlement that you can do anything, you're okay, you're beyond the law, you're not going to be punished, you're entitled, we can provide everything for you, you don't have to strive, you don't have to struggle, yung ganon. And they are very, very concerned about this, and I'm glad that people are now looking at it, no? Are we raising kids who are entitled? And they, when they become leaders, entitlement becomes very dangerous, right? Okay. Then pinagbibigyan. Okay lang yung pinagbibigyan once in a while. Pero wag mo na lang, kasi kawawa naman. Wag mo na lang i-punish yung bata kasi kawawa naman eh. Pagbigyan mo na lang. And that's very common. What happens pag pinagbigyan mo yung tao palagi? The person feels he doesn't have to take the consequence of his behavior. And the child feels na, may amo na pagbibigyan naman ako. Then entitlement again comes into the picture. No? Hindi ako mapapanish kasi siyempre, pagbibigyan ako. And so on. No? So actually, we can look at many other things, but what that means is that we seem to have that practice of rescuing our children from the logical consequences of their behavior. And that came to be very, very marked or very, 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 very important when UNESCO itself, in 2012, gathered a group of social scientists to look into what they call the culture of impunity in the Philippines. Impunity is not being punished for wrongdoing, right? Getting away with wrongdoing. So they gathered a group of social scientists. Anthropology was Michael Tan, and then we had Clarita Carlos for political science, Amado Mendoza for economic perspective, Dean Diokno for justice system, for the mass media, Dr. Tolentino, and I was for the psychology. Their concern was this. What is this all about? How come wrongdoing is not punished? It has become a culture. and they called it The Culture of Impunity. This is now published in a book called Crimes and Unpunishments, 2012, edited by Dr. Braid, Maslog, and Tuason. So it's so significant that an organization like UNESCO noticed it and wanted to do something about it. Anyway, the book is, I think, available. I'm not sure if it's available, but it must be available in National or AIJ, Asian Institute of Journalism, where Dr. Braid is the head of that, I think. Okay. So they think of that phenomenon where we allow people to get away with wrongdoing. In your own family, in your own circle, you know, do you see that phenomenon? Why do you think people, parents, adults, allow children or allow other adults to get away with wrongdoing? Literally, getting away with murder. I think we have to question it. We have to really pay attention to that, no? Because we have also been called, our attention has been called by an international organization about that phenomenon. Anyway, if you want to know more about it, you can read the book, okay? Next is discipline, what must start early. The no age, you know, everybody developmentally, we know the no age. The no age must also be, the no age of the toddler must have a corresponding no from the parent. So setting limits starts very early. And it's very important to understand also the dynamics of that, because it's not that easy that you just say no, because we also want the child to experience his own autonomy. He can do things on his own, but at the same time, we also have to say, these are certain things you cannot do. What I notice now is that when I talk to most parents, the parents seem to be now intimidated by the children. That's one of the phenomena that we are dealing with, especially since now the youth are more competent than the adults, especially in the digital age, no? Because of they know more than we do. And when they teach the lolas, they get very impatient. Ano lola? The lola will say, dahan-dahan. But the lola, I told you already. Many parents, you know, tell me this, and grandparents. So they have a certain advantage over the previous generation. Sabi nga, they are digital natives. We are digital migrants. I am a digital tourist, I think. So, parang, you know, we need to be a little bit more knowledgeable also, because then we become, they have that authority, no? Because of that, they have a certain authority over the parents because of that knowledge. It doesn't mean it's wrong or is right or wrong, but it is a phenomenon where it wasn't there before, that they have now more knowledge, more competence about a certain area, which is a very, very big area of our lives. The intrusion of technology into the family life is very, and so they seem to be more a master of it than we. And that has implications in terms of discipline, in terms of the power system, in the power in the family system. Okay, so how do we discipline? Of course, we all have positive discipline, effective discipline, and so on. Okay, let me tell you about what I've formulated. I call the 6 C's of discipline. C is not my name, but C. Okay, there are 6. Let me explain it to you. And you're going to ask me questions after this, okay? So let me give an example first. An example that I always use is there was a group of teachers, no? in a school, you know, the school. And there were grade 7 teachers. There were like 200 of them, Well, how come there were so many? But yeah. Anyway, so they said, Ma'am, can you help us enforce this rule? I said, sure, what's the rule? The rule is that the grade 7 must tuck in their shirts. Oh, I see. Okay, so then I asked, and I looked at them. They were tucked in, some were not tucked in. Then I said, before I can help you, I have to ask you one question. Who among you totally and firmly and sincerely believe that this is a rule that must be enforced? So half of them raised their hand, and half of them did not. So I said, I'm sorry, I cannot help you enforce the rule, and you will not be effective in enforcing this rule because you don't have the first C, which is conviction. In disciplining, we have the techniques, we have the ways to do it, but before we even do anything, what is inside us? Because a child can detect tentativeness the way a dog smells fear. In other words, a child knows instantly which parent ang malulusutan. Which parent can I get away with? Can I do what I want with? Which parent will allow me? Which parent will not? They know it almost instinctively because it's not in your words. It's in the shape, it's in the way you look at them, it's the tone of voice, it's the body language, the way your mouth moves, it's the way your cheek muscles, they have a way. It's a gestalt, instant way they know, dito ko kasi papayag. I'll go to my mom, I know she will, after a little while, she'll say yes. They're very, very good at that. So if you don't have the first C, even if you say you're not supposed to do that, this is what will happen if you do that, but there's no inner conviction in you. The child senses it. So first and foremost, what do you really believe? Do you really have that conviction? If you don't have that conviction, then hesitate muna. Don't try to even enforce it because it's an inner thing that communicates in every other action that you have. No? Okay, so do you have that conviction is number one. Second is, of course, clarity. It's clear to you, but is it clear to the child? Kasi ganyan eh. Okay, but why did you do that? I thought you knew. But mom, you said ganito ganon. Hindi ka clear. Okay. In other words, if the child doesn't understand it the way you think the child should understand it, you are not clear. And because you are not clear, you lose. It's like giving feedback. Even if you're the boss, if you give feedback to somebody, you want somebody to hear your feedback, to understand your feedback and accept it, it's entirely up to you. You're at the mercy of the person you are giving feedback to in terms of whether he will get it or not. So if you're not clear, then you cannot be effective. So the clarity knows. So how do you know? Maybe you can ask the child, tell me in your own words how you understand it. Because in most families, nagkakagulo because I told you already the rule. But I thought it's like this. Very common, not so. Don't take clarity for granted. Even if your words are very clear, even you say it very clearly, you are not that sure that the child got it. Okay, so just making sure. And the third is, for me, the hardest. C, consistency. Maybe I'll have to quote Eric Erickson, the person I admire in terms of developmental psych. He says something like, the parent must say the do's and don'ts consistently so that the child can become his own parent. In other words, when you say something, you shouldn't do that, continue to say it until the child internalizes it. And I have a very interesting story about this example. And I think everybody I know knows this example, but I still say it to give a point, and for those who may not have heard it, for those who have heard it, you know what I'm going to say. Okay, so there was this mother who was reading a thesis, and then the 2.5-year-old child goes to the bed where the mother was and put his dirty shoe on the bed. The mother looked at him and then continued to read the thesis. And then he got his other dirty shoe and put it on the bed and did this way and said, "Mom, you have to scold me." So, buti na lang with the mother didn't respond in the usual way. Marunong ka pa sa akin. Di ba ganun yun? Marunong ka pa sa akin. That's the usual response. But the mother realized what the child was saying was, be consistent. Do your job. Mom, you're not doing your job. That was the message. And so the mom said, okay, you must not put your dirty shoe on the bed. And the child felt good. And of course, I know that very well because I was the mom. And my point is, if we really listen to our children, we will realize their wisdom and we will learn from them. So I learned to do my job, not my job in doing the thesis, that's another job, but the job of being a mom, okay, being consistent. But there's another aspect of consistency, which is, I think, applicable also to organizations, not just to families, organizations, nations, and bigger organizations. No? The consistency is also fairness. Okay, you punished so-and-so because he did this, but so-and-so did the same, and you did not punish him. We are very, very familiar with this kind of lack of consistency. If the person has a position, if the person is privileged, he is not given the punishment. If the person is on the lower part of the totem pole, so to speak, so he is punished for a wrongdoing. The same, so consistency means one, the act, a certain behavior which is meted a certain type of punishment or consequence must be done whoever commits that behavior, whoever does that behavior, and not to exempt those who have privilege. That is the consistency that we have badly needed in our own discipline of our own country, the whole country, no? It's that consistency, which is also fairness. And if you think about it, and most developmental psychologists know this, that when adolescents are very, very particular about fairness. They really question, why did my dad say this to me and not to me and did this to my sister? They become very, very critical and very, very aware and vocal about injustice. They call injustice in the family. It's not fair. And they question it. Especially when they get to be adolescents, where, of course, you know that the critical thinking is already developed. So that's the consistency. Now, consequences. As I said earlier, when UNESCO asked about the culture of impunity, why is wrongdoing not punished? How come though so many journalists were killed and there was no conviction? There was, you know, that kind of thing. So how come we don't give the consequence of the behavior, the logical consequence of behavior? It starts very early, as I said earlier. We do not cover up, we do not rescue our children from the consequence of their behavior. Very easily said, not easily done, because as a parent, your sympathy, kawawa naman. You know, you're like, wag na lang masasaktan, whatever, or baka depressed or whatever, so let's not give the consequence. So it becomes a culture of impunity. And I think we have to be very, very aware of this because the levels of the impunity are from the basic family level to the school level to the organizational level to the country level and also the international level, like consequences and bullying of nations, things like that. Okay, so next is, of course, care. I have to put this in because before when I was lecturing about this, one person in the audience said, what about care? Yeah, I said, I assume that, but I think I put it in because in the poor communities where we usually go, in Payatas, Tuman, and all that, I noticed, I mean, it's very, very common that the parents punish their children by, you know, spanking, kicking them, punching them, insulting them, and they call that discipline. So one, a parent needs to be very mindful of what she's feeling because usually when you're very, very angry and you spank your child or you scold your child verbally and you're at the point, I call the point of no return, you are already irrational. When you see red, that means wala nang logic. You are just going to be very, very angry and you are punishing the child because you are angry. You have to be clear. And I am very angry, so I'm going to punish. Why am I angry? Pinahiya niya ako. Or ginawa niya, hindi niya ako sinunod. The anger is the emotion that makes you do the punishment. So the care is a very subtle thing, no? So you care, you discipline because you care that the child will learn to do what is right. But then when your anger comes in, it's like a child having a tantrum. When it gets to a certain point, wala ka nang magagawa. Nothing, you can say anything, you can bribe whatever you want, the child will just stick with the tantrum. Parang point of no return. I also use this in anger management. When you reach a point of no return, nagwala ka na. In other words, you lost it. Okay? So, what you can do is, you look at the process before you reach that point of no return. You pinpoint a certain part of the process where you can break the momentum. It's very interesting because one executive, his way of we looked at how he would do anger management, and it was very simple and interesting because when we pinpointed the steps, the escalation of the anger, which usually escalates if you don't do anything. It's the normal process in your mind. So all the thoughts come in, and then the emotions come in. If you don't do anything, it takes over. It has its own life. So we thought, what could he do? Since he's an executive and he cannot just go to the CR anytime like that, no? And or wash his hands, wash his face to stop the momentum, he found a way which is very simple. He would click his finger like that, and the momentum and the escalation of the anger would stop. It was a very interesting technique that he discovered for himself, no? So there, talking about care, in that one community, and I love to say this again, people have heard me, have probably heard this many times, but I think it's worth emphasizing. In the poor community where we worked, because we looked at the statistics in the DSWD and Bantay Bata, and it was the community where the proportion of abuse, no? Sexual and physical abuse was highest in that particular area. So since that was the case, what we did was we had a family systems framework where we didn't just look at the abused child and the abusive parent, but we also looked at the system where you have the abused child, abusive parent, the non-abusive parent, and the sibling. Because I believe that in preventing abuse, the system is a great help, and it's needed, and the focus on just abuse or the abused is kind of limited if you want to do something about it, no, in terms of prevention. So anyway, there was this father, a 35-year-old father, binabalibag, you know, what's balibag? Binabalibag niya. He throws his son into the wall. He kicks him. He does everything. He pinches him. He pinipingot niya, whatever. But then he said, you know, okay lang bugbugin ang bata. Basta walang dugo. Kasi disiplina yon. So, you see now that he is not, and from his point of view, he's not doing anything wrong. So in terms of preventing abuse, we don't just focus on they're poor, they drink, they do this, they do that. But what is their mindset? What do they believe in? If he believes that's discipline, he will never change it unless he realizes that that is abuse. So you work on their belief system rather than just the external situation in which they live. Okay. So sabi niya, sabi nung nanay, and this is typical, that's why I want to say it all the time. Sabi nung nanay, bugbugin na niya ako, wag lang ang anak ko. So I asked them, is this right? Na magpabug, you know, parang tam, di ba, parang kumisan sa kanila, tama yun. Ako nala, wag na lang yung anak ko. Pero bakit ka magpapabugbog? No, that kind of thing. So it make it, people start to think. In that community, started to think. Some of them said tama, some of them said hindi tama. And then the abused child said, patayin na niya ako, wag lang si nanay. So ganun na, no? But, surprisingly and very difficult to explain, the 5-year-old sibling said, mali ang ginagawa ni tatay. Hindi dapat nananakit ng tao. So, wow. In the teachings in family therapy, di ba, they learn, absorb from the family, where is this girl coming from? That wisdom of this girl, 5-year-old girl, is quite amazing. No? That she knew it was wrong. And in many situations like that, I happen to see it. Parang I start to believe that children have innate wisdom and they are also innate truth tellers until the adults in society teach them to lie. So when we were looking at it, kasi many children usually tell the truth. Ay, mong sabihin yan, baka masaktan, baka magalit, di ba, ganon. We always prevent them from telling the truth because mapapahiya tayo or whatever consequence to us, no? So I was wondering, how can we preserve this truth-telling? Because almost always, but not always, the child starts to learn how to lie. Parang more common than not. When we, it was not a very systematic research, it was just observation and looking at the cases. What I saw was that when there is an adult, a significant adult, even just one significant adult, who values the child, who gives the affirms the child, gives the child a feeling of self-worth, and tells the child that what he's doing is right, affirms, no? The child is more likely to keep that ability to tell the truth. So it seems like the child would need a significant adult who believes in the child, whom the child believes in, and nurtures that ability, and also nurtures, cares for the child. Anyway, it's something to think about and to do more work on. So that's care. And of course, communication is basic. I mean, everything, no? How do you explain? Where are you coming from? And so on. And I'd like to underline that with these 5 C's, there is one core value that we must always keep in mind, and that is respect. People always are asking now, how come the children don't respect the parents anymore? There were like a group of people saying, I said, how did you talk to them when you were disciplining them? Most often when we discipline, we insult. No? Bakit ginawa mo yan? Ang tamad mo talaga. Hanggang ba yan? Ang tanga mo talaga. There's always that hindi mapigil na bibig. Alam mo yun? Parang bakit ginawa mo? Kaya talaga ito. Tanga-tanga. We have that. And it's also reinforced in on television, radio, on the comic books, whatever. Parang it's a thing that happens and we take it for granted. Parang it's a normal thing. No. Merong ganong meron palaging kasunod yung wrongdoing na parang insult. And I'd like to emphasize that because there was a national survey done in the 2005 somewhere there by Trends, which is a reputable organization, somewhat like SWS. No? And I know the one who was doing it before was Mercy Abad, who was quite reliable. And they had a whole study sampling the usual sample of the SWS, which was like 2,000-something. Diba yung national opinions, who is the president, yung mga ganon, SWS survey, that way. And they wanted to know the opinions of youth on different topics. Many, many different results, but I'll focus on one which I found to be somewhat not very much noticed. The question was, is it still okay with you? Okay pa ba rin ba sa inyo kung ang parents nyo ay pagalitan kayo or sabihan kayo pag meron kayong ginawang hindi tama, that they will still guide you? All of them said yes, including the college students. Hindi nila sinabing, alam na namin. They said, yes, it's okay with us, but please do it with respect. That was the finding. That was their plea, no, to the parents. Please do it with respect. The punishment or the pangangaral or the correcting the wrongdoing, just do it with respect. That was their request. And that finding was somewhat lurking in the background. I just saw it and wanted to give it some prominence because I think it's very important. And where is respect most violated? And I say this when I give talks. So I gave a talk to all the networks. Baka masuna naman ako. Remember, I was sued already. So, for protecting a child from abuse. Okay, so I talked to all the networks and I said, you know, the most violated value in media is respect. It's not just the example of the child dancing the macho dance. Okay, that's a very graphic example. And that's where I was sued because I said there was abuse. But the child was certainly humiliated again and again and again. I'll stand by it up to now, that there was certainly abuse and humiliation in that episode. And if you saw the episode, the episode in totality, it's not at all as mild as what you saw in the YouTube. It was really, beer pa, ganun, ganun. Basta it was really humiliating. Parang ginawa, ang bata ay ginawang laruan. Instead ng bata ay maglaro, siya yung laruan. No? Parang ginawang object of entertainment, ridicule, pakatuwaan, that kind of thing. So anyway, when media persons do interviews, sometimes they have a question that's very leading, and if you don't answer it the way they want, they'll ask it in a different way. I had this experience recently, and I said no, in a very, very, very top journalist, because I knew that this person will ask me a question, put me in a spot, and I will answer in a way that he doesn't want me to answer. And bakit pa? So I said, no more stress in my life. It's okay. Don't interview me. So anyway, so it's really a very noticeable behavior among a lot of media people. But I also said this in front of all the media people. Anyway, when you're 70-something, it's okay. You can say whatever you want. When you're sued, people will be there to help you. Okay? And that's what happened. Lawyers will volunteer. Good. Okay. So I'm also tying it up with, if you remember what recently what Pope Francis said, he said many things, but one of the things he said about environment and about the behaviors of people and the priests and the bishops, he said something very significant that is also related to respect. He said, these things are happening now because right now, nothing is sacred anymore. And it was very powerful to me that he said that. No? He was lamenting the wanton destruction of environment, abuse in families, and bullying among nations. You know, nothing is sacred anymore. That's what he said. And I think we have to look at that. No? Okay. So, next, in terms of parenting, nation building, next topic I'd like to look into is building self-worth and dignity in the family. I think Lotta had mentioned this already. Punishing wrongdoing without insulting, out of that common practice, correcting wrong behavior, and affirming right behavior. Because as a mother or a parent, sometimes we say, it is my duty. I've done my duty. I've corrected the wrong behavior of my child. Yes, right. We feel it very much our duty. But did we ever also think for a moment that it is also our duty to affirm them when they have done something good? I think it's getting better now. But before, it was really like, as a good parent, correct the wrong behavior. And you are doing your job. And then on. So if you notice also, affirmation in families, in our Filipino families, is not very easy to come about. Parang meron tayong nakakaya naman, anak ko yun, I'm affirming my own son, parang there's something embarrassing about it. Mga ganon, meron tayong some kind of ganong klaseng, you know, pag-iisip. So, I think we have to balance, when we discipline, we balance the no with the yes. We balance the wrong with the right. And it's like a bank account. When we have affirmed the child many more times, it's easier to say to the child that you're doing something wrong or to correct the child because there's already a foundation or a fund of yeses. So it's easier to say the no, and it's easier for the child to accept the no. Because it is not always no. There is a yes. And as a young child, when we say don't, what is the do? Oh, we usually forget the do. Don't do that, but the child, what will I do? The only thing in the mind of the child is the don't. Kasi walang alternative. No? So if you say don't, give a do, especially if they're a very young child. I had an experience when I was still squatting in the clinic of my husband, who's a neurologist, and I just came back from my studies. I had this boy, an 8-year-old boy, who was referred by a pediatrician because he was already getting too much na hindi na kaya ng mama niya to discipline him. So I entered the office of the pediatrician, and of course, may umiiyak na baby, and you know how it is. But I spotted the boy because when I entered, I heard the boy say to his mom, "Ayoko sa'yo, pangit ka, sisipain kita." I said, "Oh my God." So he proceeded, the mother was just like this, no? So sabi ko, "Well, I think this is my boy." So I brought him to the clinic of my husband. I had a my toys would be in a bag, because I was an itinerant play therapist. I didn't have my own office, so I'll spread it there in his table. There was a phone. He had a phone, but I had a play phone. Anyway, so this boy comes in. He was about 8 years old. Then he goes in, comes into the room and then he proceeds to use the phone, the real phone, okay, and not the play phone. So I said to him, no, let's say, Mark, hindi yan ang pwede mong gamitin. Ito, pwede mong gamitin. Of course, he proceeded to do it at least maybe 5 times. But of course, if you're not the mother, you're not going to be emotional about it. It's easier to say in a voice that's not angry, Mark, hindi yan ang pwede mong gamitin, pero ito, pwede mong gamitin. Pero yung nanay, bakit hindi mo ba naintindihan? You know, anyway, you know what? Parents all know what I'm talking about. But I was a therapist, so it's easier. Anyway, to make the long story short, the 5th time he looked at me with what I interpreted as a look of gratitude, that someone persisted to say no to him and did not give up until he followed. And I tie this up with other experiences where there was a 13-year-old girl brought by the mom, and the mom was very, very, my heart was, my heart went to her because she said, I gave so much to this child. I gave everything and I gave up so much, and now this is what she's doing to me. Hindi siya sumusunod, naglalay, hindi tamad, lahat-lahat ng mga. And then when I talked to the child, somewhere along the way, the conversation, sabi ng child, I wish my mom would have told me when I have scolded me or told me when I was doing something wrong so I wouldn't become a bad person. So the child also has a need to be disciplined so that he does not become bad. Because if my mom told me this was wrong, maybe I'm not going to be a bad person that I am now. So there again, you know, the wisdom of the child. They need to be disciplined. It's their right and need to be disciplined. So that's the thing of the how important discipline is, the fiber of the family, the fiber, the nation. I mean, where are we as a nation in terms of discipline, in terms of self-discipline? Let's ask ourselves. Do we do what is right even if nobody's looking? Or we just do it because somebody's there? The police will give us a ticket, whatever. Okay, so have we internalized? Yeah, that's the question. Okay, so I'd like to emphasize this again. We have a, think about it. I believe, or I observe, that we have this kind of belief, kind of a cultural myth na bata lang yan, wala pang alam. So pag nag-uusap, pinag-uusapan yung bata, parang wala siya doon. Wala pa namang alam yan, hindi nakakaintindi. Basta okay lang, hindi mo nakakaintindi yan, maliit pa yan eh. Totally wrong. I think a child before even 1 year old senses the there's something wrong. A child is wise. And there are many, many examples of this, which I will not go into now. Maybe you just ask questions if you want. So we carry this belief until adulthood. And so I think it's very, very important to make people aware that we have this belief, and it's not good for our children to grow up as adults believing that bata siya, wala siyang alam. It is undermining the self-worth of the child, the dignity of the child, the nature of the child, that the child has wisdom. I cannot resist this other story, which I've told people also. I was doing a dissertation. I was directing, I was a dissertation advisor of one of the former students in a long time ago when I was not yet retired. And then I got very harassed, you know, not not being able to say no when I should have said no. Got too many things to do. I said yes, yes, yes. So I said, sorry, that I can't meet you now for your dissertation because I did this. I'm so harassed already and all that. I think I'm feeling sick. So she goes to her 2.4-year-old son and says, Francis, Lola Honey is sick. What should she do? And the boy said, let her be quiet. So I said, today I am learning from the wisdom of a 2.5-year-old boy, I'm being quiet. How did he know that anyway? Really, I mean, it's really amazing. Okay, so that's one thing I'd like to advocate, that we look at our children differently. No, not just we love them, we clothe them, we give them the best food, the best clothes, the best toys, and the best in life. But do we really listen to them? Do we really hear them? Do we really know them? We care for them in a very, very physical way. But I think it's not very often that we really believe that they have something more than just the physical thing that we take care of, okay? Now, building integrity in the family. Let me take 72. You cannot live without the water when you're giving a talk, okay? So, integrity in the family. How does integrity... How can one build integrity in the family? Because integrity now is the issue, our issue, during this time of selecting our leaders and all that, right? Integrity is a big thing, okay? So integrity is not just honesty. I think one can be honest and not have integrity. But one cannot have integrity without honesty. Let me give you an interesting example of a very honest person. There was a husband who was dying. Okay, in his deathbed, his wife was there, and he told his wife, he confessed to his wife that we've been married for 50 years, that 35 years ago, he had an affair, and then he died. So the man was very honest. But did he have integrity? Did he have compassion? What did he do? He was brutally honest to relieve himself of his guilt and put the burden on the wife who is living, so that the wife now, how will I mourn with, you know, I mean, he relieved himself of guilt, put it, the problem and the burden on his wife, and then he died. I think it's not just, it's honesty and cruelty at the same time. I mean, why did you have to tell her now, then you die? I mean, you know what I'm saying. So integrity is honesty with compassion, caring for the other person, the impact on the other person. So it's not... purely just telling the truth. It has to have empathy. It has to have a caring attitude, no? In terms of being honest. So you don't have to be brutally honest. There are myths in marriages and families where you have to be brutally honest and tell everything. I think that's dangerous. I think it's not even necessary. So integrity is discerning. The first step in integrity is reflective discernment. You pause. You think, is this the right thing? Is this right? Is it congruent with my core values? Before you make a step. Because then when you make a step and you want to retract, that means you are not mindful or you are not reflective and discerning enough before you acted. Integrity requires first discernment, no? Reflective thinking, reflective discernment is one aspect of integrity. Of course, integrity, integer, is also wholeness. You are a person who is solid in terms of a core set of values that you anchor on every time you have to make a decision. So if something is happening and you have to do something, go back to your set of core values, and that is what will determine what you will do. That is integrity. It is being solid, being whole, not being fragmented. That's why I believe that if there is an opposite of integrity, it is corruption. As Stephen Carter, I believe him, because corruption corrodes. It erodes. It divides. It's the opposite of being whole. So there, you know it's wrong and you do it. So there is a divisive self. No? It's not buo. The self is not whole. And so there is conflict. You know it's wrong, you do it. Now, if the person is so used to lying, that lying is, that when he lies, there is no more division, there is no more conflict, no integrity, but no more conflict, then I think even a lie detector will not work. Because a lie detector, why does a lie detector work? Because when we tell a lie, there will be bodily reactions that will be triggered by the lie, because you know that you're violating something integral in yourself. So corruption, I believe, is the opposite of integrity. So I think that issue is very relevant today. But think about it, because it's almost time for us to discern. People with integrity are people without integrity. Okay, so it fragments, no? Corruption fragments the self, divides the self, conflict the self, whereas integrity is, you are the same inside as you are outside. You are who you are, wherever you are, whoever you are with, you can be who you are. If you are with corrupt people, you are still who you are, you will not be corrupt. If you are with people who are drug addicts, you can be there, but you will not be carried away, because you have a solid set of core values, a solid integrity of self. So I think, how do you do that? I mean, how do you develop that in a family? I think that's the question. Of course, needless to say, you have to model it. You have to be a person, a parent of integrity. That's number one. But there is also one way that I think may not have been really put into the forefront, which I believe is validating feelings, validating the true feelings of your child. For example, the child comes in from the school, sabi niya, I hate my teacher. The teacher talaga is so bad. I mean, galit talaga ako sa teacher na yan. Kainis yung teacher na yan. I don't want to see the teacher. Of course, the usual thing, oy, teacher mo yun. Wag kang ganyan. Hindi dapat nagsasabi ng ganyan tungkol sa teacher. That's the common reaction, right? But what if we do this? We say, bakit magalit na galit sa teacher mo? And this is really what happened. And then the child said, see, I saw it with my own eyes. My friend was sitting there, and then this boy was sitting here, and then the boy did this something, and then the teacher scolded my friend. That's why I'm very angry. The teacher is wrong. I don't like her. So what's the one way to build the child's solid sense of self? You can say, nakakagalit ngayon. Siguro kung ako rin, magagalit ako. Affirm, validate. Don't be afraid to validate a feeling, because then you are making the child develop authenticity and truth. no, inside. You are validating a truth because nakakagalit naman talaga. May right ang child magalit. Buti na lang nagalit yung child. Tama yun. Pag di nagalit yung child, parang wala. Di ba niya alam na mali yun? No? So, validating feelings, I think, is very, very important, but we don't usually look at it as something that we do or we must do. In fact, if we validate authentic feelings and we are able to be authentic most of the time, we don't need psychotherapists. You lose your jobs. We lose our jobs. Why? Because I believe, for example, in psychotherapy, one definition of psychotherapy that I always say is, psychotherapy is that artificial hour when you can be most real. It might be the only time in your life when you can be most real and you are not punished for it. Because this is the job of the therapist to listen and agree, right? But we unconsciously and as a way of life are very negligent or not aware that feelings, even they are negative, must be validated. I had a child, a mom, and she came to me because her child was so sad. So she said, I'm really so disturbed. My child is so sad. The child was like a four-year-old girl. I said, oh, really? Yeah, yeah. Well, anyway, so she turns out, to make the long story short, the grandmother died, was very close to the child. Then she said, I'm really very worried. Why? She's so sad. Then I paused and I said, you know, I think I'll be more worried if she wasn't sad. It really shows you that most of the time in our families, children are not allowed to be sad. It's very true. Huwag ka nang malungkot. Bakit ka malungkot? Parang there is something wrong. The child has the right to be sad. I mean, if there's something to be sad about. But as parents, we want to rescue the child from the feeling of sadness. We don't want a child to be sad. Of course, that's okay, but if the child has a reason to be sad, let us give the child the privilege or the allow the child to be true and to be sad. No? Kasi parang nare-reflect sa atin, bakit malungkot yung anak mo? Eh, anong klaseng parent ka? I think we have to be very aware of these subtle things that are, you know, we don't think about, but we automatically do not want our children to feel. When they're very angry, ba't ka nagagalit? Hindi dapat nagagalit. Eh, nakakagalit eh. Dapat ka magalit pag nakakagalit. So, it's our own discomfort in accepting negative emotions that makes the child inauthentic and that makes the child lose that sense of solid trust in his own feelings, in his own judgment. Therefore, the solid sense of self is not formed because we negate the truth inside the child because of our own discomfort. Just think about it. Okay, next. So we rescue, we cover up, we put each other down, we put ourselves down. And why is this so? And how can we change? Okay, as I said kanina, the power, the family, I believe that the family is still the most powerful social unit you can ever belong to. Why? Because as children, we absorb values, attitudes in the family through a very powerful subliminal process that is uncritical, effortless, and unconscious. Because at that certain stage of childhood, we still don't have that critical thinking to think or to even think that our parents can be wrong. We just absorb it so totally, even without, you know, just in our own total person as a child, get it. It's deeply embedded, it's deeply rooted, and it is transmitted from generation to generation until we become aware. And we do something about it. So when I was teaching this course many years, many moons ago, decades ago, family therapy, marriage, and things, and those courses, I would always say, you know, you can still be pattern breakers. But let's look at it, be aware. What is it that your parents did or your mom did to you that made you feel so bad? And what is it that made you feel that was good? And what is it that you want to do to your own child to repeat? And what is it that you want to change? The only thing that can make you do that is awareness, consciousness, and mindfulness. Without that, we will just parent automatically the way we were parented, because we are not, in schools, we are not given the course to sort out whatever until maybe we're in graduate school. But, you know, that's why it is called generational patterns, and they're very, very strong. So mindfulness and awareness are the keys to how we can change patterns. And that, I think, is something that we have to really focus on. Awareness. How is it? And there is a book that's a very, very insightful book called Parenting from Inside Out by Daniel Siegel. Parang, if watch the movie Inside Out. Okay. But this is like, it really shows you very clearly that we have certain issues that we have not resolved, and that's how we act towards our children, because we are not aware. Like this guy was buying a pair of shoes. The child was buying a pair of shoes, and he got so mad in the store. And when he talked to his counselor about it, it was because there was a time when his mom was buying him shoes, and so many things happened, and there was a trauma that happened to him. But he was not at all aware of it until that happened, and somebody made him look at it. No? So parenting with mindfulness means you are aware of what is going on inside you. What are your issues? What are the things that you are, the trauma that you're carrying inside you, that you are unknowingly, almost automatically putting on your child? I'm not saying this very well, but it's always what I see, no? That unresolved trauma, unawareness of parents always lead to doing it to the child without being aware. And the child, of course, doesn't know that that's going on until the child gets a critical mind and then is able to know my parent can be wrong. And think about this. When the child is very, very young and the mother is unloving and neglectful, the young child will not think of the mother as unloving, but rather will think that she is unlovable. The message is what she gets. She doesn't have the ability yet to say that my mother is neglectful, but she will think that she is unlovable. The power of the message of the parent is not so much, discussed. We are not so aware of that very, very powerful subliminal process that messages are transmitted to children. I had an 8-year-old girl who thought she was dumb. I'm so stupid. And she was, of course, not dumb. Her grades were 88. She was a smart kid, maybe above average, not superior, but she was certainly not dumb. And when I saw the family, I saw how they interacted. She had two older brothers who were brilliant and gifted. And what happened was, when they were doing a task, the brother would say, "Ako na lang gagawa para mabilis. Sige, tutulungan kita para magawa natin." Very helpful, very generous. But what's the message? Pag akong gumawa, hindi magagawa. Pag akong gumawa, hindi mabilis, hindi tama. Kaya gagawin niya para sa akin. How subtle. No, the brother is being very caring, But the message she got and she actually got is that she is not capable. She is dumb. How subtle the message, the process was. And you can't say to the brother. So actually what happened was I said, okay, now we'll do some tasks and everybody will just do it their own way. Okay, we will not be teaching each other how to do things because people do things differently and it's okay. So when they're about to rescue, they were told not to do it for her because she can do it her own way. But what I'm saying is the process is very subtle. It's very subliminal. But when the child is an adult, it comes out. I had a graduate student who was tall and dressed well, and she said she was so ugly. Why do you say you're ugly? Of course, this is in group therapy, and it's confidential, so I'm not saying any name or anything, but it was a long time ago. And it's a very interesting, subtle, no words almost. What was happening, she reenacted it in class, and she said, it's like this, I have a younger brother who's very cute. So everywhere we go, family gatherings, reunions, everywhere, people will go like this. Let's say you're the brother and you're the girl. Ano, balik tayo natin. You're the brother and you're her, okay? So the people will go like that. Ay, ang cute, 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 cute. Ay. Yun lang. Anong message? Wala naman sinasabing pangit ka, wala naman sinasabing anything. But she got it and she was 25 and she said, now I know. Why am I feeling that I'm so unattractive? I mean, subtle, very subtle. So, and then this another girl was saying, why am I ugly? I mean, hindi ako maganda, gano'n sabi niya. Ah, talaga, bakit mo sabi yan? You know, the mom would say, oh, your cousin is so beautiful. You know that as a child, when your mom says, you know, your cousin is so magaling. And then this son of your uncle, wow, he's so wonderful. And this sister is beautiful. Parang, why you're telling me, ako. Parang ganon, di ba? Hindi masabi ng bata, pero when she recalled the words in her mind na, nga ano, parang ang gaganda nila, ano, ano ko. Hindi pala ako talaga, hindi ako maganda. The message is so, so subtle, but so strong. Because this girl is now 45. And this is the first time we are talking about her self-concept and identity. No? Anyway, so almost there. Mindfulness. It's deliberately paying attention, being fully aware of what is going on both inside yourself, in your body, heart, and mind, and outside yourself, in your environment, without judgment and criticism, worn by kindness and spiced by curiosity. It is being reflective, being looking at yourself, and knowing how you're feeling at the moment and owning it. Okay, so you had the fight with your boss. You go home, and of course, the easiest victim to display your anger on is your child. So you're very masungit. You're angry with the child, but you are not being mindful that you are carrying this angry feeling even before you saw your child. Okay, so mindfulness is so essential in the way we parent, in the way we want to parent, so that we parent in a way that we know what we are doing, and we are not like robots just doing things that they are without reflecting, without pausing. So when working women like me come home and they say, no, lagay yung bag dyan. Oh, naluto mo na ba yun? Nanagawa mo na si ganito? Ganun, ganun. Okay, wait. Pause. When you come home from a traffic, from work, pause. And feel, I'm tired, okay? I'm going to go to the bathroom, wash my face. You know, parenting from inside out, knowing what's going on inside you and owning it, being responsible for it, knowing that it is you, okay, and not projecting it. Okay, then you are fully aware, of what's going around, and when you accept this without judgment and you practice kindness and compassion. So, Lota has said this earlier, discipline, dignity, integrity, and self-worth, I believe, are the best gifts we can give to our children. And perhaps these are what our country needs most today. Okay, so thank you. Before I thank you, I'm advertising. We have a parenting academy, the second one, on, where is it? February 27. Anyway, that's, thank you. There it is. No, that's the anniversary. Okay, sorry, that's another one. This is an invitation to our anniversary of MLAC. 5 years of mindfulness, love, and compassion. And I'm giving a talk on creating circles of integrity to fight corruption. So if you're interested, there is the website. You can look at our website, hopefully. We will be create circles of integrity, enough mass of people with integrity to fight corruption. So thank you for listening.